woke up this morning just recognizing and realizing that it's so easy in any day of the week at any time with all the things going around us. If you're challenged like I am, it's very difficult just to fix my eyes on Jesus and not be focused on other things that are completely out of my control, really. I can have some bearing on things, but when I think about it, really what I can really engage in is what's within my sphere of influence and what's in my daily life. And so I try to learn not to concern myself with those matters that are beyond me, and I take those to the Lord and pray. But yesterday, maybe it's because it was a long day, I'm tired. I just was beginning to get my eyes off of Him. And so this morning I went to a familiar passage, Hebrews chapter 12, just to remind myself what the writer there says. And so I wanted to share those thoughts with you. That's where I spent my quiet time this morning. I didn't read any in the Proverbs, but I think maybe there's an encouraging word for you as well that we'll find in this. So with your Bibles, if you have them, turn to Hebrews chapter 12. We're going to look at verses 1 and 2 this morning. Father, I pray that God, as we look at your word, God, the Holy Spirit would draw our hearts and our attention to you. God, we know that we don't do this just as rote, check off the list, but God, we need to hear from you this morning. Father, we need to have the Holy Spirit empower the word of God, Lord, and bring it deep in the recesses of our heart, Lord, that we might be conformed more to the likeness of Christ, to be encouraged through your word, God. And Lord, while we live in this world, God, we cannot escape that. But God, at the same time, that we have the right perspective that you are a sovereign God and you rule and reign over all. And so, Lord, we look to you this morning, God. Open our eyes and our heart in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the author of Hebrews, we really don't know who it is. There are a lot of speculations, but he begins in verse 12 after he's concluded, and I'm not going to go back through all of the context of Hebrews, but in chapter 12, he begins to conclude where he says, therefore. Now, we know anytime we see in Scripture the word therefore, we always ask the question, what's the therefore? Well, he's referring back to what he stated in Hebrews chapter 11, where he goes through a whole list of God's people. And to reiterate the fact that their walk was by faith. The Bible declares, apart from faith, it's impossible to please God. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. And so our walk with him is faith. And we've said before, it's not blind faith, not at all. But it's faith based on evidence that we know that we see God operative, we see God's promises are true, etc. And so he takes us back to Hebrews chapter 11. And I think maybe in particular, as his train of thought is there, as he's listing all of those that are there in that list in Hebrews chapter 11, he may have on his mind the last individuals that he listed. Because they walked by faith, and they never saw the promises of God as the previous ones had seen God's promises revealed to them. In other words, the situation didn't change. They went on to find a what we would think of in a life situation, a demise rather than victory. But the victory was not in the outcome. The victory was where their faith, their assurance, was set. And so he starts by writing this. He says in verse 38, some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with the sword. And they went about in skins of sheep and goats. Here the picture is in the arena, in skins of sheep and goats, where they would be thrown into the arena for entertainment, where the lions would attack them. And he says, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy. wandering about in deserts and mountains and dens and caves. And so it's in context of that. He says, therefore, you believer, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, the image there is that all of these individuals have preceded us, and they are there with the Lord in heaven by faith. And we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, as if they are watching us in that sense. And he's causing us to reflect on them and see that we're surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. Because of that, let us lay aside every weight. Now stop and pause there for just a minute. What is it that weighs you down? What weight of worry or care or concern or anxiety is a weight in your heart this morning? Is it the fear of COVID, catching COVID? Is it the weight of changes that are taking place in our government? Is it the weight of where our country seems to be sliding in a decline? Not seems to be. Our country is sliding in a decline morally. Is it the weight of worry over kids? Is it the weight over worry of job? Whatever that weight is, we have to understand that the writer here is telling us to cast off those weights. Now, it's not easy just to put them out of our mind, and that's not what he's saying. He's saying, don't let it weigh you down. Don't let it drag you into worry and concern and fretting and misery, and can I say, making others around you miserable because you're weighted down with these things. He says, therefore, look at these people. Look at that cloud. Look at the things they endured. Look at those who lost their lives in horrific ways, and they would rather die because they knew and anticipated what was to await them on the other side. He says, throw off every weight. And then set and the sin also, which clings so closely. Throw off those things that are weights. The sin, the worry, which by the way, worry is a sin. It's not trusting God, and I'm guilty of it just like all of you are. He says, throw those things away. Cast them aside. And then he says, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Now, here is an athletic image. Back in the day when I was a marathon runner, I wore as little as possible when I was running a marathon. And as far as clothing and any water or gels or any of that kind of stuff. The reason was I wanted every ounce of extra weight off of me because I knew I had a race that was 26.2 miles long. And I knew that about mile 22, that monkey was going to crawl on my back and it was going to get real difficult to finish those last 4.2 miles. And so here the image is, listen, when you're running a race of endurance, those things weigh us down and they keep us from running or even completing the race. I can remember that at about that point in the race, it was easy for me to want to drop my head and began looking at my feet plod. But I had to discipline myself and look at the next marker that I could fix my eyes on and not concentrate on every step, but I had to look ahead. Maybe it was a bend in the road, maybe it was a stop sign that was a quarter mile up the road, and that's where I had to fix my eyes. Because if I didn't, my eyes would be taken away from the goal of finishing the race, and it would be placed on how difficult every single step was that I was taking. And here, that's the image that the writer gives us. Listen, if we're so focused on those things that lie right in front of us, we will miss the prize and miss the goal that's set out before us. And so he says, fix your eyes on Jesus, he follows that, rather than fixing your eyes there, fix your eyes on Jesus, verse 2, looking to Jesus, the author or the founder and perfecter, or the completer of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising its shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And so here the image is in life, as we are walking and living the Christian life, it is a race. It's an endurance race. It's not a 100-yard dash, but it is a long race. And rather than fixing our eyes on situations and things that we have absolutely no control over, he says, fix your eyes on Jesus. And so I was reminded this morning that those things that are around me that I have, I can mitigate some of those things, but I really, at the end of the day, can I tell you that you have no control over it? We have very little control, really, of our own lives, if you really think about it. Rather than fixing my eyes on those things only weigh me down and they drag me down and they pull me into that miry pit. And unfortunately, I can pull others along in that with me. He says, fix your eyes on Jesus. And when he says, fix your eyes on Jesus, there are a lot of things that come to mind there. He says, fix your eyes on Jesus and consider him who, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. Jesus looked at the goal of the cross, and the goal of the cross was the securing of our redemption and our salvation. He didn't consider the pain and the suffering and the shame that he would endure on the cross, but he looked beyond that to see what would be obtained through it. And so here the author says, consider Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, putting it to shame so that he might die on the cross, shed his blood for a payment for our sins. And he knew that he would be raised from the dead and seated at the right hand of the Father. And so this morning, let me encourage you, whatever it is that's weighing you down, whatever it is you find yourself drawn to every day that seems to just drag you down and keeps you from fixing your eyes on Jesus, make a determination. This is what we can control. I can control what goes into my brain. I can control what feeds my brain. It can be the media or it can be the Word of God. It can be social media or it can be the Word of God. It can be the negative voices that may be around me or it can be the Word of God. Today I want to choose to let it be the Word of God and the promises that are in the Word of God. God is in absolute control. Listen, fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior. Life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace, through death into life everlasting, and things of the earth. Over us in no more have dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Oh, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full. The light of his glory and grace. thankful in His wonderful face, and the dreams of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Would you hum that refrain the rest of the day? Just think of that. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. And anytime today something begins to draw you away, sing that in your heart. Tell yourself, self, fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Well, I pray that God gives us an opportunity to sow a seed of the gospel in somebody's heart today. I pray that God would use us, that we'd be conscious that everywhere we go, people we come in contact with, God wants to use us. That we cultivate maybe that seed that's been planted in their heart. Or if God, by His grace, would let us participate and watch, see somebody place their trust in Christ and their life changed. May God use us to do that today. I pray the Lord's blessings on you, that He would just bless you and keep you in His love and in His arms. Encourage one another in whatever way you might find opportunity to do that today. I love you. I look forward to seeing you tomorrow morning. Have a blessed day.